Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info. It's one of many enduring mysteries in solar physics. Why is the sun's lower corona hundreds of times hotter than the sun's photosphere? For many decades, scientists have sought an answer to the puzzle, though always doing so within the confines of the standard thermonuclear model of the Sun. Recently, the ESA and NASA Solar Orbiter spacecraft returned to scientists on Earth the closest images of the Sun taken to date. Some mission scientists are speculating that the images may reveal clues to the problem of coronal heating. A principal investigator, astrophysicist David Bergmans, points to what he describes as, quote, campfires in the images. He states, "The campfires we are talking about here are the little nephews of solar flares, at least a million, perhaps a billion times smaller. When looking at the new high-resolution EUI images, they are literally everywhere we look." A NASA press release on the images states, "It's not yet clear what these campfires are or how they correspond to solar brightenings observed by other spacecraft, but it's possible they are mini explosions known as nanoflares. Tiny but ubiquitous sparks theorized to help heat the sun's outer atmosphere, or corona, to its temperature 300 times hotter than the solar surface. To know for sure, scientists need a more precise measurement of the campfire's temperature." Ironically, a 2016 phys.org report entitled "The Mystery of Coronal Heating" emphasizes how wildly inappropriate the campfire analogy is in any attempt to explain the sun's hot corona. The article states, "Imagine standing around a roaring campfire roasting s'mores. You feel the warmth of the flames as the marshmallows crackle. Now back away. You get cooler, right? That's not how it works on the sun. The visible surface of the sun has a temperature of 10,000 degrees Fahrenheit. Backing away from the inferno should cool things down, but it doesn't. Instead, the sun's upper atmosphere, or corona, sizzles at millions of degrees, a temperature 200 to 500 times higher than that of the roaring furnace below. For more than a half century, astronomers have tried to figure out what causes the corona to be so hot. It is one of the most vexing problems in astrophysics." As he's done in previous episodes, we asked Dr. Donald Scott to explain why the sun's super-hot corona has always been a predictable feature of the electric sun model.
As if just about every couple of weeks recently, some official arm of the astrophysics community issues a press release that reveals just how far off track the mainstream really is. It's almost getting to be like a press conference where the interviewers throw out softball questions to the speaker who's waiting for them and hits them out of the ballpark. Now, I don't know if I'll be able to hit this one out of the ballpark, but it's not exactly like that, because we here in the Electric Universe, Thunderbolts Group, never know what these folks are going to say next to demonstrate how uninformed and uneducated they are in the areas in which they claim to be experts. So we have to be ready for just about anything that the fortress astrophysicists put out. And they really do live in a fortress. It's a closed shop, and they refuse to acknowledge we exist. So anyway, for example, there have been a couple of these press releases in recent days, and I think it's crucially important that we respond to them. About 2 weeks ago, on the July 16th, ABC News, and I said, oh, ABC News. No, that's the Australian Broadcasting Company, Don, not the American Broadcasting Company, released a press release entitled "Solar Probe Snaps Closest Ever Pictures of the Sun, Revealing Campfires on the Surface." And I thought that when I said, you got to be kidding. Well, let me quote from the press release. Quote, "The discovery of thousands of tiny solar flares that scientists have dubbed campfires, offering clues about the extreme heat of the outermost part of its atmosphere." Let me end the quote there. Of course, I want to talk about their use of the word campfires, but also this last gratuitous comment that they hung on the end of that first sentence about clues that they see about the extreme heat of the sun's outer atmosphere, which of course is its corona, the lower corona, shows they still haven't figured out the cause of the lower corona's extreme temperature. For decades, they wondered why there was this extreme jump in temperature as you came out of the sun and up into the corona. Well, one of the most basic and important contributions of the electric universe is Ralph Jurgens' electric sun model, which was published back in the 1970s. Jurgens' model inherently explains the high temperature of the lower corona and many other phenomena about the sun that the gravity-only mainstream still finds enigmatic because it's electrical and they can't explain it electrically. They refuse to. Jurgens and the rest of us in the electric universe have been, and continue to be, completely ignored by the power structure called accepted astrophysics, or I call it fortress astrophysics. We have presented dozens of space news videos just like this one that discuss and explain the temperature anomaly that worries them so as being completely understandable as the result of the acceleration of positive ions, electrical acceleration of positive ions, leaving the sun, that collide with more static ions and neutral atoms just below the corona. And their use of the word clues, to me, it's very interesting because it sticks out. It implies to me that they see this still as a mystery. If it wasn't a mystery, you have clues to mysteries, but you don't have clues to things that are very explainable by accepted theory. Jurgens published his paper back in the late 1970s. Where have they been for about 40 years? This was a 28-page paper containing much evidence that the sun's photospheric surface is highly electrical in nature. But astrophysics public relations people certainly love quaint and whimsical phrases like campfires on the sun. Maybe they think of themselves as being so much more informed than the rest of us that they have to talk down to us as if we were children. Or do they actually think there might be big campfires burning up there on the sun? Anyway, they included several images, and one is a multiple image. It does indeed show some bright points on the photospheric layer. But Jurgens discussed these back in 1979. Saying they were fountains of electrons called spicules in the sun's chromosphere being ejected upward in a self-regulating plasma mechanism to maintain a strong electric field at the photosphere that produced that self-same change in the temperature that bewilders them so. Anyway, it involved creation of what is now called a double layer. Irving Langmuir, an American scientist, had discovered and published his work on the double layer requirement back in the early 1930s and been awarded actually the Nobel Prize in 1932 for doing it. But these guys have never heard of it. Anyway, many images of the sun obtained over many years, many decades actually, show bright spots just like this. And in many diagrams of the various solar layers, you see these spicules, these fountains of electrons. What we see in the sun are the various forms that plasma creates there, nothing more. Anyway, many photographic images that have been taken over the years show bright spots. And were these people unaware of it? New photographs were taken, I guess, very close to the sun, but they're no better than many other photographs we have of this same phenomenon. Spicules are thin, elongated jets a few hundred kilometers wide. They reach up to 6,000 kilometers in height, and they can move around at speeds of more than 100 kilometers per second. And spicules are found all over the solar surface, but they can be observed and photographed most easily near the limb of the sun. The bright spots also may just be locations where the streams of incoming electrons are stronger, denser. But wait a second. Didn't they realize the word campfires? That was actually seriously used by astronomers in the 19th century in another embarrassingly long period of time when they had no answer to the question of why the sun is so hot and why it doesn't burn out. These were the years around the beginning of the 20th century when atomic energy was being developed, you know, the Curies and all that. So they desperately latched onto this atomic fusion process in the last-ditch effort, like a drowning man grabs a life ring, to explain the sun's tremendous and apparently everlasting stream of output power. But why do they reuse that word again now? You would think they'd be embarrassed by it. They ought to be.